So welcome back. I hope the others will also come, but I have to admit that the weather is very nice. But the weather seems to be always nice here. So. Okay, let me just start with repeating what I tried to point out, that there's a difference and similarity between coherent superposition, which is the basis of quantum parallelism. Let's say if you have a state, classical state 0 and the classical state 1, usually that's it, but in quantum mechanics you can have, let's say, a 50-50 mixture of that one. And if you then go to the Lightwave apartheid configuration, you can have a state like this one, whereas the first bit refers to the first particle and the second bit refers to the second, which looks a little bit like that. So this is coherent superposition. But in the multi particle configuration you have entanglement, meaning that the state is not a product state. Of single particle state. What does that mean? That you have, this is not something like psi 1 times phi 1. That this is the first particle. This is the second part. This is the wave function of the second part. And I try to argue this with a Mermin-type argument. With Mermin-type, I mean that it's contained in the book Quantum Computer Science by Mermin. Okay? Now, I'm not sure if anybody is still coming. Probably I ask you now if you have still questions. So basically the coherent superposition is characterized by the co-encoding or simultaneous encoding of classically disallowed, jointly disallowed bits, of the co-encoding of classically different or contradicting bits. Yeah, and this is the cause of hopes that there will be a kind of quantum parallelism. That because with one bit, that's quite meager. You have a speed up on the codes of two, but if you have n bits, you get an exponential speed up because you can have inside one of those states, you can have 2 to the power n terms. Yeah? And this presents some hope that eventually you will be able to get an exponential speed up. And quantum entanglement is a hope that communication complexity will be enhanced through this feature of entanglement. The main feature of entanglement, in my opinion, is the possibility of relational encoding among bits. So the single bits lose their identity and lose their definiteness, the states of the bits lose their definiteness, and the joint state contains all information in terms of joint properties. Let's say, typical joint property is, if the first both particles have the same spin, or both particles have different spin in direction x, let's say. Yeah? And this has been first described in the context of measurement in the 30s by Schrödinger. Schrödinger said that in the measurement context, this is how he argued entanglement, or how he discovered it. Schrödinger said that you can have it that a particle who would be in a definite state then interacts with a measurement apparatus and establishes a correlation, a relation with the measurement apparatus, but both lack individuality. And lack of individuality, Schrödinger argues, is associated with random outcomes of single particles. This is the Schrödinger argument. So he had it already. All the ingredients were already there in the 30s. And this is totally impossible, to my knowledge, in classical theory. It's a new feature of multi-partite systems. Okay. Now we come to the evolution, the state evolution. And again, I very much encourage you to look at the Mermin book. Mermin Quantum Computer Science. The chapters on his webpage. Because what makes Mermin digestible to a larger audience is that he introduces the quantum notation at a very, very early stage and works with a reversible classical computation first, and then it's easy to make the transition into the quantum notation. Let me show you how. He identifies a classical bit and he uses already the vector notation, which is very uncommon in classical bits. Yeah? But, you know, if you like, this is a vector, but this is not a null vector. Let's say it's small o. And he identifies with the cat, and then he says, well, we can formalize this by this vector, and he has a 1, which he writes in the cat notation as this, and as I said, you can identify this with the orthogonal vector, and so that if this kind of thing, 0, 1, and then he says, well, classically, what would classically be a reversible computation? A reversible computation would make it possible for a computation to go back to its original position, not to lose any information, and possibly also not to gain any information, which means that all you can do with these two bits is to get the identity operator, which corresponds just to the identity matrix, to the matrix carrying ones in the diagonal, or to the x, to the not operator. Now, what does the not operator do? As is already presumed by its name, the not operator transforms a 0 into a 1 and a 1 into 0. Yeah? Because if you do this, if you do matrix multiplication, you have here and here equals 0, but here and here equals 1 is 1. And these two operations are also allowed classically. You can do nothing to the bit, oil-looking solution. And these are also reversible. Now, in general, if you have more fits, you can single out the category of reversible computations by a very simple procedure. You will find that those matrices, that the transformation corresponds to matrices, it transforms vectors into vectors. Yeah, so this is this matrix. And the matrices starting from multiple bit states like this here, classical bit states, these matrices contain only a single one in every row and in every column. And the other things are zero. So in 3D, you can have this, let's say this. So when you start, you know this is a 3D matrix. You start out with a one here, then this is already dead. Because you're already here. Now you can have a one here, and the one here kills you this thing, and the only remaining one is in this one. And in that way, you can be sure that classic states of this kind, I mean in 3D this would be a threat. Yeah, whatever that means classically. But you can map only a single bit, no mixture, okay, into the other. Yeah? So the identity, say, maps every bit into itself. Or the not operator on a bit transforms the bit value. But only there's no coherence superposition. And this one characterizes in general a permutation. So we are talking about permutation matrices. Reversible classical computation in terms of those bit states and permutation matrices. This is all there is. And now in quantum mechanics you have a very similar thing, but you have generalized permutation. Generalized permutations allow you still a one-to-one mapping, but they would allow also mixtures between states. And the generalized permutation matrix is the rotation in real space, just rotates the vector. Because also a permutation, it doesn't kind of rotate, but it's kind of discrete rotation, permutation. But a rotation, just an arbitrary rotation in whatever space is involved. 2D, 3D, 4D. Thank you. No, okay, let's not waste water.
Okay.
Thank you.
Great attitude. Thank you.
Thank you. So, and if you want more of it, in Berkeley they said, you know, BSMS, PhD, you know that, you know. In Berkeley they told me bullshit, more of the shit, but I am deeper. Now in quantum mechanics, higher and deeper means the unitary transformation. And these are very general. So you have permutations, you have rotations, or unitary transformations. This is these unitary transformations are in complex Hilbert space are characterized by a variety of options. One option would be that we transforms this equivalent. Yeah? Equivalent. I have all kinds of equivalent in my manuscript. On my webpage, I list many equivalent characterizations. One is due to Schweber, for instance, he says, Stringer. He says, a unitary transformation, and this is very known to mathematicians, this is just the ways of characterizing unitary transformation, transform arbitrary orthonormal bases into other orthonormal bases. Yeah? This is one way of doing it. So, for instance, it says you can, if you have one unitary basis, and you have the cat, and then you have another one.
Yeah.
This is and here they have orthonormal basis. This is one characterization. Another characterization is that it's an isomer, that is the norm is preserved. Once the norm is preserved, the scalar product is preserved. This is another. So it's length preserved. Length preserved. The easiest in one dimension, the easiest unit transformation is a unimodular factor, A of I alpha X. Yeah, preserves the norm, doesn't do anything in 1D. It's a unitary transformation. The permutation would be just one. Just one. Because it's more restricted. But in a complex space, you have more of them. So, yeah, there are other characterizations. Preserves orthogonality, preserves angles. These are all, if you want proofs, they are all in my manuscript. I forgot them. I have to admit that for that. But basically they are contained, for instance, in there exists a very nice book. If you look into the details of the elementary details of vector spaces, it's by Heimov, Finite Dimensional Vector Spaces. Very nice book. Heimov. It's an undergraduate text, but it's really sufficient, I think, for most of quantum mechanics. Okay, so what have we got? We got a pure state, which can be a composition, or in more physical nomenclature, a coherent superposition of classically distinct states, basis states. In multi-particle environments, you got entanglement. These are the states. You get weak states by partial tracing. I will not go into the details here. Please excuse me that I do this. If you force me, I will. But partial traces, just a statement. Then, with respect to observables, the observables are formalized by, in real dimensions, by orthogonal matrices. No, by symmetric matrices. Which have the property that they are identical to their transposed, and in complex space that the Hermitian conjugate is identical to the original matrix, and you have unitary transformation, yeah, and I forgot how the most common, these are all equivalent, you know, I mentioned some of the characterizations, but the most common property of a unitary transformation is that the Hermitian conjugate, or in real vector spaces, the transposed, is the inverse matrix. So the existing inverse, everything is 1:1, and it's just the Hermitian conjugate. Probably I should say something about group theory, just one remark on group theory. Nobody told me that during my education, but I think it's an important finding, an important fact. That group theory, in group theory there is something called Taylor's theorem. Taylor's theorem states that basically all groups can be written as subgroups of the permutation groups, of the symmetric group. So basically this forms a group and everything is a permutation. So basically the model of quantum computation, or model of quantum mechanics evolution, is based on a group theoretical model of permutations. We are permuting the state. Okay? There's one. Taylor's theorem says, or group theory says, that all groups are subgroups. This is on a subgroups of the symmetric group. And the symmetric group consists of all permutations. So you just look at the group space and you look at all the permutations. And the worst that could happen is that everything gets permuted into everything, then you have the symmetric group, but there are subgroups, subcycles. So this can be, I mean, they wouldn't, mathematicians don't like the term permutations for continuous groups, like the unitary group, or the rotation group. But it's 1:1, it's bijective, and it's onto. So it's an ejection. So we have basically the possibility that the quantum evolution of the pure state, also of the mixed state, but the quantum evolution of the pure state is just a generalized rotation. The ghosts of the wind agree or disagree, whatever. So now, I mean, these are difficult things to digest for the first time, but they are not really extremely complicated. There is another process that has the difference between those processes has been known since Feynman's book, but has been cited in also Everett's paper, Ralph Mockfuss. There was Ralph Mockfuss' article about the relative state formulation of quantum mechanics, which, you know, this is irreversible. But at measurement time, the state makes a transition. Let's say this state here makes a transit either in 0 or 1. So information is lost. This is no longer a unitary transformation. But it is, it's also not a permutation. It's something different. How it can be modeled is a mystery. I it's all unresolved. There have been models, non-linear models, Gerard, or whatever. But effectively you say if you measure something, you make it definite. You cannot touch, as I said, the vector, so you have to measure parts of the vector, obtain information from doing measurements, and this kind of is an irreversible step. You don't know if you measure, let's say, a 0 or a 1 here, you don't know from where it came from, you know?
If there would be a model, this would mean that it's not random.
What?
If there was a model to describe the observation, that would mean that it's not random, right?
Yes, well, it's depending on the model, of course.
The model by itself could be random.
If sweep the stochastic model. But the alternative is more severe as it looks usually, because people are getting kind of conditioned into the formulas. As a physicist, they teach you how to not ask questions, in a certain sense. You know? Because Feynman, the one who threw out Gauser out of his office, says in the character of the physical law, if you can possibly avoid asking these questions, don't ask them. Explicitly says this, because you will be heading towards a blind alley nobody has ever escaped. Anyway, so some of it was also warning people of these kind of interpretational issues. But of course this didn't prevent, let's say, Heidelberg or Einstein asking nasty questions. And actually there was a group formation. One group was around Planck, was quite old, and Schrödinger and Einstein on one side, who were, Planck says, causality, we shouldn't give it up, it's kind of a signpost which is useful. You know? And the younger generation of Born, of course Bohr, but Born in particular, and Heisenberg, Pauli, they were very much into accepting that these things are just happening, you know, there are gaps in description. I was talking about the theological creatio continua. And it's interesting that probably 300 or 400 years after the start of the Enlightenment, after Galilei, they seem to rediscover irrational elements in nature. Of course, but one thing is clear, one cannot prove that these are provable, that these issues are really totally random. So that they are absolutely random, or one can also not prove that they are deterministic. So either way, it's blocked by Hilbert-type incompleteness, Turing-type incompleteness theory. But as our experience tells us, 100 years of intense to make the thing deterministic, to make the measurement process in any way deterministic, failed so far, at least from a general perspective. I personally think that this is not the entire story. I think there is a kind of context translation introducing noise from the environment. I think this is what really happens, and as an effect, you get stochasticity. But the idea, but the choice is the following, the principal choice is the following. Either you accept that there is unitary transformations ubiquitous, that is everywhere, and then the measurement is purely conventional. Because this is an argument by von Neumann and Everett, say that look at the apparatus, the measurement apparatus and the observed object and put them in a bigger box, and if both of them are described solely in terms of quantum mechanics, they have a unitary wave function, which is totally reversible and totally deterministic. So even the measurement, so what you call measurement process is totally reversible. But from the point of view of the measurement apparatus, it appears to be irreversible. So there is so you either have the choice to say that there is a second evolution which has little to do with the unitary evolution, which is fundamental to quantum mechanics, which changes quantum mechanics, and which is evolved in every measurement process. Or you say there is no measurement that is not non-conventional, that is not conventional. Everything is conventional. Yeah? So because what you consider a measurement, somebody who has more knowledge may not consider that as a measurement. And nowadays there exist experiments, quoting quantum erasure experiments, where you can kind of measure it and restore the wave function. But of course, as these are unitary evolution, you have to use up everything. You cannot use this panic trick to measure something, copy the measurement results, because also copying is disallowed. You know, this is another issue, the no cloning theorem. Copying is disallowed, and you cannot just go away with the measurement result and reconstruct the wave function to this penetrate. I should also prove that copying is disallowed. I have not done so. I will do that in a minute. So again, the choice is to assume that quantum mechanical formalism of unitary state transformation is ubiquitous, that is everywhere valid, and then measurement is just a convention. Or you assume that you have to modify the unitary transformation or augment it with a non-unitary element, state evolution, which would make you this irreversible element. I personally, there is no other choice, I believe. Probably I have not the imagination enough, but my personal opinion is that we should rather stick with the first option, to conventionalize measurement. And there are certain good reasons, also experimental reasons, to argue for that. The no cloning theorem. The no cloning theorem says the following thing. This was, by the way, from a historic perspective, was an interesting development, because the proof of the no cloning theorem was stimulated by a paper which claimed that if it would be possible to clone, to copy quantum bits, generic quantum bits, then it would be possible by EPR type arguments to communicate faster than light. This is the so-called flash paper of Heidelberg. And they published it, although Shirabi, I think it was Shirabi, said that it is wrong because of the right reasons, but he didn't publish the referee report. So nowadays he goes on by telling people that this is his referee report. But it was then Mount Daveland and Docent and so on, who had this insight. And the result, the no-plugin theorem, states that you cannot copy an arbitrary bit in the way you copy, you do it in a copy machine. So you take an arbitrary bit and a blank paper, and you transfer it to two arbitrary bits. That's not possible. So let's just try out how this could be formalized. Let's say you have two bits. And these two bits are copied in that way. This is also contained in the learning, I think in the second chapter. Now, if you make a permission conjugate out of that and apply this side here to that and this side to that, the permission conjugate, this you must believe, there is no time really to do it, so I just kindly ask you to believe me that this results in that, yeah? And this results in the bra vector. I also didn't talk about dual spaces because I had no time for doing this. So these are parts of the dual space. And apply it over there. So you do the following. You say sine B times psi B equals to or transits into phi, this is phi, this is a psi, and psi. So this goes with that, so I get a phi psi here, and the remaining factor BD, blank paper, let's say this is normalized as one, and here on this side you get 5 psi squared. So effectively you get an equation saying that this can be done if that is the case. Yeah? So if you assume that this is just a, because this is a constant, this is then a squared. So a equals a squared. And this is true for a equals 0 or 1. So psi and phi should either be orthogonal, in this case it's 0, or collinear, in this case it's 1. So you are always allowed to copy orthogonal or identity, to copy an arbitrary autonomous system of your choice, even in quantum mechanics. But you are not allowed to do the following thing. You are not allowed to do a coherent superposition. Let's say alpha for a bit alpha psi plus beta phi. You have the blank paper, and because this should, on an ideal machine, also reside in alpha psi plus beta phi squared. But if I use linearity, in these equations here, I just get alpha sine psi plus beta phi phi. And what I lose here is the interference terms. I lose also, so this is proportional to alpha psi phi, alpha beta psi phi plus two of them. No, so you get it too, yeah? So because this is more, you know, you have to also here in this ideal copying everything, also the interference terms are included. And they are not included if you extract the linearity of the unitary class here, because this should be a unitary class. So basically you cannot copy an arbitrary bit, but you can copy two bits which of your choice if they are forming an orthonormal basis. This is the risk of the no copy arbitrary. No problem. Okay. With this heat, it's really a little bit of an experimentation to continue with the spectral theory. Because what we should formally do is, after looking at the basics, looking at the decomposition of operators, and finally at issues related to commutability. That is, if I have a normal operator, what is a normal operator? A normal operator is usually an operator. If you take the commutator, it's Hermitian conjugate of the operator with its Hermitian conjugate. What's that? This should be rule 0, then this is called A is normal. Now, any operator like Hermitian and unitary operators are normal. Why? Because the Hermitian operators are defined by the fact that their Hermitian conjugates are identical to the original operator. The unitary operator is defined by the fact that the inverse transformation is identical to the Hermitian conjugate of this operator. And inserting this into lattice, so you get H Hermitian conjugate equals to H equals to h squared minus h squared equals to 0. So it's normal. And also, u Hermitian conjugate equals to u minus 1 equals to u minus 1 minus u minus 1 u. This is the identity. Identity minus identity is against you. So this applies in particular to Hermitian and unitary operators. They are both normal. And then there's the so-called spectral theorem. applicable to unitary intermission operators, as I just demonstrated. Then normal operators, just as unitary or emission operators, A have a spectral decomposition as A equals 2 sum. These are the eigenvalues. Now what are the eigenvalues? The eigenvalues of the operator is a value lambda I such that if you apply the operator to an eigenstate, to the given eigenstate, again gives you the same eigenstate multiplied with the eigenvalue. So the eigenvalue is just, the effect of the eigenvalue is just to multiply a multiplicative constant. And the spectral theorem says that for normal operators, you can do this decomposition. Here are the eigenvalues, and here are the projection operators that correspond to these eigenstates. So let me see. What time is it? 45. Let me just continue with the spectral theorem. This is just part of it. The second part of it is that the sum of all those projections forms the identity. And the third part is that these projectors are orthogonal. So they are zero for I not equal to J. So this is basically the spectral theorem. And what that means is that, for instance, a Hermitian operator can be characterized in terms of its eigenvalues times the projectors. The projectors, again, are, in the non-degenerate case, just the additive products or tensor products of the respective eigenvectors. And the sum corresponds to a resolution of unity, and all those projection operators form our orthogonal projection operators, and they form thus an orthonormal basis. The maximal operator is one let's talk about maximal operators later.
Excuse me, I'm just joining now.
Yeah.
A little question. Is that the commutator or the top?
Yes, this is the commutator, this is the Hermitian adjoint. And I'm just formulating a spectral theory. I'm saying that.
A spectral theory, okay.
Yeah, it's. In cases where the operator is normal. Normal means that you take the operator, plug it in, plug its Hermitian conjugate, or in real vector spaces it's transposed matrix, plug it in there and form this, this is just a definition of...
But my question is that the commutator is...
Minus.
Yes.
Thank you.
So I was thinking there was an identity.
No.
It's minus.
You are absolutely right. I'm totally...
Yeah. You were thinking of Poisson, right?
Yeah. It's the equivalent form of the Poisson. Okay, so we got this. So what does this mean? This means that one can think of a normal operator or a Hermitian operator and observable in terms of the projection operators, of which it consists. And all those projection operators can be thought of, this is the dual role in quantum mechanics, as pure states, or as the proposition saying that the system is in that pure state. And if I apply the operator A, I measure lambda I. And then it must be in a pure state corresponding to this projection operator or that vector. And
one little question. Are you in a finite dimension?
Yes, always.
Yeah.
I erased that already. All I'm talking about here now comes from Heimov, finite dimensional vector spaces. It's a very nice book, an undergraduate text in Vienna. So, and now we are going to Kolchin-Specker in a certain sense, because we are talking about commutativity. There is a very interesting, other interesting findings as well, which I cannot reveal, but there's a very interesting theorem saying that if there exists a set of operators, AI, let's say, a set of operators, all mutually commute, such that AI, AJ, usually commute. Then, first of all have similar spectra. That is, the projection operators inside their spectrum are identical or compositions there. I mean, there can be degeneracies and so on. But if they are non-degenerate, then all these operators have identical projectors. So if this is just one-dimensional projector, then it can happen that this is A1 plus AX plus AY. You know? But if this is just one-dimensional, so in the most primitive case, derived by Kolchin-Specker, they have re-derived this. Several people have re-derived this result. It's fine. So, similar spectrum. And it's the same. This differs, but this is the same. And this is the funniest part, the most interesting part in my opinion, also used by Kolchin-Specker. First, second, there exists a maximal operator. R, such that all operators AI are functions of this maximal operator. Actually, the function is a polynomial in finite dimensions. That's funny, isn't it? So if you got a set...
Exactly, like, except of one which is not the maximum and one which is.
Okay. Okay. Let's say I have two computing operators. Let me just do that by the spectral sum, yeah, in two dimensions. So I have, and I make it the most naive one. Yeah? So A1 equals, prime numbers, 2 times 1000 plus 3 times 0001. Yeah? So this is just the 10 times 01. Yeah, this is a projector in A2 equals to 5. 1 0 because they don't have identity. Plus 7. So this amounts, this is here 2, 3, and this is 5, 7. So then, I look at the spectral composition, and I use, let's say, as my maximal operator something that is non-degenerate, and I use 1, 2. Okay? So, I want 2, 3 equals 2F 1, 2, 0, 0 which, in this I have told you, for the functional application. Because one of the things that is important is that for reasons I will tell you later, in a minute, this f of a equals to sum according to the spectral theory of I f of lambda of I a I. Why is that so? Because, you can have mixed projections, but the mixed one always returns zero because these are orthogonal according to the spectral theorem, and because of the projections or polynomials, they are even for them. So you just, but whatever power there is, in the case it ultimately becomes a single projection. So what I do is here, I can do the following. F of 2 times, let's call this E1 and this E2 plus f of, no, I'm sorry, f of 1 plus f of 2 and this has to be then 2 and this has to be then 3. And you take another function g of r which should give you the a2. Yeah? So you take g of one two equals to 5007. So this again.
So that works only if this spectrum is non-degenerate.
No, no. You can. You know, this is. He just said, give me an example. And of course, I chose the simplest example.
Yeah.
But it also works for the general spectra, but you have to be more careful. Because the general spectra contain projection operators which are not only one dimension. So you have to carefully arrange. And these two were higher dimensional projection operators. You know? For instance, it contains something like E. E1 times E2 times E3, you know, so there are also orthogonal projections which are even potent, but they are not, they don't consist of pure state, which is wrong. So I, because he was saying, give me this one, I gave him the easy one. Typically mathematicians do, always choose the lazy option. So this is G 1 times E 1 plus G 2 times E 2. So this one is 5 and this one is 7.
What's 7 over 2?
Yeah. 7. So this is almost trivial if you write it out that way, but yeah.
I think to understand when does R is arbitrary, R you use
the
a maximum rate. What is the maximum?
The R has to be non-degenerate. You know?
Yes.
With respect to, I mean, it can be also degenerate if all those A's are degenerate in the right way.
But what do you mean by maximal?
With maximal, I mean that basically all things which you co-measure, you can think of actually measuring only one thing, that's the maximal. So from that you can derive anything which is co-measured. Because co-measurability is associated with non-complementary. This is associated with the commutative equals U.
So maximal is rank.
It's
the rank, maximal rank.
Yeah, the maximal rank. Yeah, it's okay. It's the maximal rank should be the dimensions.
In all the coordinates has numbers.
Yeah, so should be the dimension.
But at the same time.
So the idea is really, and this is what I think is also the of Coach Baker, you don't think of the context, because the maximal operator I'm going to identify with the context. You know, that's the maximal, that's like a basis. You think of it as every the biggest thing that you can, the biggest chunk of observables that you can know simultaneously, that you can do without coping with complementarity. And you really think of those things really in terms of one operator. So all this, the whole diversity of co-measurable operators will collapse into one. This is the gist. What present day is called context is really, just a single, need not unique, but a maximal operator which can be used to derive all those commuting operators. And the easiest way of thinking that, easiest example would be to think of a maximal operator in terms of a basis. Because in terms of an autonomous basis. Because you start out, it looks complicated, but it is actually very easy. You start out, let's say, with the Cartesian thesis A1, E2, E3, and let's say this is 1, 0, 0, this is 0, 1, 0, and this is 0, 0, 1. And you form the projections, which is 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. I'm lazy now, I just throw at 1 here, the others are 0, and here is the 1 here. And then you form an operator, let's say the R, you form with primes, let's say you form 2, but you can do whatever, 1 plus 3, 1 plus 5, 1. And from that, this is now what I'm going to do is I'm saying this is null basis. And in terms of Grigio orthogonality diagrams, you just draw a single line where a single line characterizes an autonomous basis E1, E2, E3. And at the same time, it's just this R here. And from that, all observables can be derived carrying E1, E2, and E3 in the spectral decomposition.
What's this explanation for this operator, the maximum operator? The same that is given for finding the maximum energy of an operation,
no.
Of a non-Newtonian.
No,
it's also spectral, right?
This is purely algebraic.
Okay.
Yeah, it has, because the maximal energy is associated with the energy operator, which is okay, but it's associated with the eigenvalue.
Yeah.
It's associated with the eigenvalue of the energy operator. But here, I'm talking about the decomposition in terms of the projections. This goes into functional analysis. So I'm just using the other chunk of the spectral of the decomposition. 10 minutes, okay. Yeah, I think this is we are ready to go deeper into real quantum logic stuff now. Yeah? So I'm ready now to show you the following thing. I'm ready to show you this thing. This is called L2. That's simple, That consists of two maximal operators or contexts. This is a context. one, and this is context two. And they are intertwined in this element. And this is just this logic. This configuration. So you have basically two orthonormal basis systems, two triples with a single common leg, and the other elements are just rotated at the same angle. And we will construct from this, because we will construct a lot of things. For instance, we will construct such a thing. Dikowski calls it, you know, this has been developed a couple of times independently. It's like the theorem. People have discovered this. You know, this is a collection of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 contours in 3D. Kalbach calls this the house, you know. I should say first this pentagon. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And you can have, I'm very bad in drawing this. 1, 2, you know, this has the pentagon and the pentagram are isomorphic. You just relabel it. But they're identical as per permutation. Yeah? So this is Kalbach's house, you know, because you can construct such a thing here, and so on and so forth. And this has a final property, and with that I will just to give you a teaser what this means. So this is a quantum structure that can be represented by quantum observables. If you interpret that classically, this, you would say that this here has always three outcomes, and only one has to be, if there is a classical interpretation, one of them has to be true and the other is false. So if this is true, and this is true, this has to be false, this has to be false, this has to be false, and this has to be false. So this has to be true, and this has to be true, and you are dead already. You cannot do this. So whenever this has to be true, this has to be false. So this is the first step of the proof by Specker. And Specker, they had this diagram 2 years before the original paper in another paper. Nobody reads. But the original paper nobody reads. So anyway, so, yeah. So this is an end. You know, if you realize this state here, the classical prediction is that if you produce this state, you will not measure this. But quantum mechanically, this is not orthogonal to that, so you will measure something. So this is already an instance, much simpler, of quantum mechanics, not motivated by Bell type arguments, but truly quantum mechanics. Yeah. So I don't think that too many people realize that. It is in the literature, you know. Several people invented this, starting with stairs and others, or even before stairs. Anyway, so let's just. But the basis of all this are these commutativity laws. Yeah.
I got a bit lost. So then you were going to
like, yes, please.
Right. So the observables are this combination of the basis of their orthonormality, and this R is any combination of that. And to that you call it context, or something like that?
No, context only if it's non-degenerate.
Yes. It is non-degenerate, yes. Okay. And if the observable share one of the bases?
One more, but in three dimensions it should have only one.
Only one?
Two, then it's
so, two different observables sharing one axis.
can draw this.
Yes. Yes.
And the point is that you will reach some logic consequences of the draw. That is more or less the idea.
Yes, I will interpret. I will. Quantum mechanics, I will use these just vector space constructions. No? I will use to obtain these diagrams.
Yeah.
But then I will interpret them classically. Because I insist, if it has a classical truth value, you know, this is counterfactual. This is in the paper of Spender. Because infuturability. This is an old scholastic thought. What if I measured something? I haven't measured it. And I cannot because of complementarity, but if I would have measured, would this have been a definite outcome? And the final proof is that I give you such structures where there is no chance of a two-valued measure. There is no way of assigning values in a consistent way. But there are structures before that already have no classical counterpart. This is a zero of Cochin Speicher. Nobody reads the Cochin Speicher paper. But it's zero. So already if you cannot separate two such atoms, you are dead. So if you have a set of two valued states which are non-separated, this is much earlier than the full construction. Requires much less observatives.
And why can the observable not have two states?
Here it can. There exists a lot of two way. I can give you a classical model mimicking that one. Or here also. This has 11. This is a funny talk about this. This is a funny diagram because everybody talks about this. This is the Klitschko inequality. Klitschko invented this. Has been. Yeah. I mean, these still have classical analogs. I can give you automaton models or finite models which would mimic that. I did quantum cryptography with finite field models.
I get it right. So when you put this red box and you said this is true, then the other has to be false. You're thinking that only one pure state has to be measured. So if you measure one, then the others cannot be instantiated, isn't it? Something like that.
I really can only measure this one.
The context. And just one outcome from the context. So in this pentagram, if any of the vertices is a measurement,
I have to decide. The other ones I cannot measure.
Okay, but if you fix one and one is true, then I don't understand this. If you put one true outcome in one vertex, then the other two have to be false, and the other two have to be right, and that is not possible.
No, there exist 11 measures of the pentagram. I should draw 11 pentagram. I draw 11 houses. Yeah, this is Kalmbach. Kalmbach calls it the house. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Oh, I should draw that in black and white. I mean. I will give you just the ones in black, okay? So, the first measure, this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, and there must be 11 in here. And for some reason, I'm drawing another one. It's an exotic candidate. So the first one, you can say this, you know, then this has to be that, then you can draw this, okay? second one this, and that. One. Okay? I'm just drawing the ones.
Each context has just two possible measurements, or more than one?
No, each context must have one and the other zero.
How many other zeros?
In this case, this is 3D, so...
Three.
There must be three.
Ah, okay, I see.
Yeah, it's four, I see. That's much more. So, then I go on this piece. And I do this and this, or this, and do, you know, this and this, and then I go on with this, and there's this and this, and I go on with this, and that. And then I do that, and that, that, and that, that, and that. That, and that. And then you have to do here.
H is equal to 2.
Here, and here, and here, here, and here. Here we have the post-centric one. Okay. There are no more, believe me. I have been borrowed a program by a colleague, Joseph Complex from Prague, who does gorgeous. I'm very happy because it's very complicated to get all this. And the exotic measure, is this in one half for some reason. But this one cannot be constructed for those. You should have to discuss this. But this is already 20 years before this. So, this is the house star diagram or pentagram. Because they want to have it devil. It's just marketing. Good to have it there inside. So. Market for it. Okay, should we stop here?
We will come back in 10 to 15 minutes as you wish. There is coffee, cookies, and bring some sandwiches.
Take a look at this operator.